y'all don't mind, let's go back to a time we really used to have church. We used to have a good time, praising the Lord, in spirit and in truth.
I love them old
church. That old brother, pick up that old hymn book and
singing,
you knew exactly what he was gonna say. Sisters got happy. Folks start patting their feet, clapping their hands, and
singing,
all of a sudden, he break off in a song, something like this.
You have read to your hearings from the book of John, the chapters 18 and verse 39 and 40, and I want to use for a subject matter this morning from this great text, the worst election ever. The worst election ever. As you look at the text, you might say, well, I don't really see an election, but I'm going to show it to you. Amen. And then I'm going to show some components, some comparisons, make my points, and turn the lesson over to you. Let the Spirit of God move as it severely will. Hold, trust, and pray that you're sitting with your Bible in your hand and scriptures open and hearts open, mind ready to receive the engrafted Word of God, which is able to build us up and give
Amen.
Us a head among many.
Amen.
The Bible says in this great book, in John chapter 18, during the time in Jesus' final hours and his time that led up to the cross, that there were two choices that could have been made on this great feast day. And in this time of these choices, as Pilate had beat our Lord and Savior, had him beaten, scourged through the night, spit upon, he had been abused, and through trickery and shame, man took the Son of God and was preparing him for the cross. Here we find that there was opportunities for men to make the right decision, to make a good decision. And then, knowing God like I know God, sometimes I wonder if we ever can make the right decision. Because we never know the mind of God, the power of God. And sometimes we do things, we may think that it is wrong, a wrong decision or a good decision, but if the decision is not according to the will of God, it is not much of a decision at all.
Amen.
In fact, when we look at this text, you're going to find in your decision making that really God has everything under control. In fact, in the book of James, chapter 4, the Bible says that when we go about our day, that we must not proclaim that we're going to do what we want to do, but if it is the Lord's will, we shall do this and we shall do that.
Amen.
So let us dive into the book of John, chapter 18, verses 39 and 40, and the lesson will be yours. The Pilate said unto him, verse 39, but ye have a custom, that I shall release unto you one at the Passover. Will you therefore that I release unto you the King of the Jews? First choice. I don't know if he was Democrat or Republican, but I know he was a choice. The Bible says they cried, then cried they all again, said, not this man, not Jesus, but Barabbas. And Barabbas was a robber. People clearly had a choice of Jesus Christ, our Savior, the matchless one, one who had traveled the Jericho roads during this time, the one whose record was impeccable. He lived amongst men, yet without sin. They had a choice to select Jesus on this custom, to exemplify the custom, to release one at Passover, pointing to the freedom and the redemptive power of Christ. But they refused to enjoy what God had prophesied, that there is forgiveness for those who face the cross. There is forgiveness for those who find themselves in harm's way because of one thing or another. And I don't know about you, but that's a sermon in and of itself. If I was preaching in that area, I thank God that God is a forgiving God.
Amen.
I thank God that God is a merciful God. And that God planned to be forgiven. He planned to be merciful. So when there was a Passover and when there was a custom, the custom pointed to the redemptive power of our Lord and Savior.
Amen.
And in front of these people was a redemptive Savior who was redeeming them before their very eyes. In fact, the decision not to choose Christ as a Passover, which would have required a lamb to die, Jesus knew that he was the lamb that was to die.
Amen.
And so it made sense for them not to choose Jesus, because they would have had to get a sacrifice when the sacrifice was standing right in front of them.
Uh-huh.
These two candidates on the other side, Barnabas, who was known, had a reputable reputation. He was known, much like Donald Trump, for his violation of women. He was known for murder. He was known for thievery. But as we look at the circuit polls, and we find similarities in these two candidates, one who would choose Jesus, whose name means and who is the Son of God, Barnabas' name in the Hebrew literally means the Father's Son. So we look at the candidates, they seem to look alike. Jesus is the Father's Son, but Barnabas' name says that he's the Father's Son. Mm-hmm. Stop by to tell you, there are churches that look like the Lord's church, and they may say Church of Christ, but what makes it the Church of Christ is the doctrine that's taught within the Church of Christ. You might be careful about folks that have names on stuff that look like and sound like, but you can make the wrong decision and find yourself not choosing Christ, but choosing a Barnabas in your life. How we find that the popularity poll, that Jesus was not popular. Mm-hmm. How unthinkable that someone who helped the blind to see, helped the lame to walk, and the deaf to hear, and dead raised from the grave was not popular. In fact, when we look at the polls, we'll find that there's a rendering that Jesus was said to have a devil, that he was known as a robber, that he was known as a person who hung around sinners. But yet, when we look at the work of Christ, we'll find there was no truth to such things. But he was like us, yet without sin. Amen, somebody. When we look at Barnabas, it was factual, just as things have been factual in its election, in that one candidate had accusations about him, while the other one had a tape recorded or a history of hurting women and being a racist and bigot. And yet we stand here and call Jesus Christ the Son of God a devil, deny him and resist him. And Pilate said, I want to put both of these people in front of you, and I want you to choose who it is you're going to serve today. And I want you to know that right now, this very hour, God is saying that I want you to choose right now in your mental state, your capacity right now, in your spirit. Will you praise me this morning?
Amen.
Or will you sit out here and act like I'm not God? Will you praise me this morning? Or will you pray? Let Barnabas, I praise you. Will you choose me this morning? When we look at this, we'll find that in the text, in this contextual setting, in John 18, 39 and 40, we'll find that even the things that happened today were happening then. Number one, there were people who didn't vote during Jesus' time. There were people that knew that God was going to be took before man. They knew that there was going to be a decision made. They knew that his life would be on the line. But the Bible says that when the time came, that all of these folk forsook him. They left him. That when the time came for the vote to be made, that they scattered amongst themselves. How sad is it to see your Savior taking the cross for your sins and my sins? And when it was time to stand up for it, we dropped our heads and went to sleep. We walked away. We took off running. We left him at the cross by himself with all his mother and his brother standing there. And it's sad to see folk, even today, who don't choose to make a decision to take a vote, to take a stand for Jesus, and to walk out on Jesus, and to go on and to leave the church in whatever condition that is in. But we serve a good God, y'all. I say amen. If we look at today's vote, we'll find that in the 2016 election, there were some that did not vote. Just like there were some that did not, those that were close to him did not stand for Jesus. We'll find that in this election, 55% of the electoral people that could vote refused to vote. That meant that this president has received less than half of the nation's approval, or the nation voting for him, and Hillary did not turn out half of the voters, that most of us stayed at home and did not vote. In particular, only 11% of the African American people came out to vote. By numbers, that meant that 2.3 million African Americans refused to go to the polls and make a vote. I don't know, maybe they looked at the track record and they looked at what was put in front of them and decided, I just will abstain from my vote. But when I look at Jesus' track record, And I stopped and talked to the woman who had an issue of blood for 12 years. She tell me Jesus was all right. Y'all know what I'm saying? Amen. When I stopped by and talked to Mary, and she's standing at Lazarus' empty tomb, she would tell me that Jesus is all right. Somebody ought to say amen. When I stopped by and I talked to the blind man and asked him what they asked him, he tell me that I don't know if he's a sinner or not, but all I know is that I was blind, but now I can see.
Amen.
I don't know about you, but he got a good track right now. I can remember some times when I didn't have, and God was my help. He's got a good track record. I remember times when I was sick, I was tired, I was disgusted, and God lifted me up. He's got a good track record.
Amen.
I don't know why you're not voting, but I tell you what, if there was ever time to vote, it was time to stand up for Jesus.
Amen.
As he faced the cross for your sins and my sins.
Mm-hmm.
Not only this, Jesus gives us a clear answer. This is our answer today to why so many left the polls and refused even to participate. What if I told you they weren't supposed to vote?
Mm.
What if I told you they were supposed to scatter because it was God's providential will? Don't you know that don't nothing happen on the face of the earth that God don't have the whole world in his head? Am I right about it?
Oh,
you mean to tell me that Jesus' 12 friends, his disciples, people that he worked with, were supposed to leave him at the cross? Yes!
Uh-huh.
It was God's design for there to be a poor voter's turnout. Y'all ought to say amen. It didn't look good. Don't sound good.
Uh-huh.
But God knew that they were going to leave him at the cross. Y'all ought to say amen. And so when we look at what's happening today, don't be alarmed that what we've seen take place, it could be God's plan in effect. Am I right about it? Back to the Bible I go. In the book of Matthew chapter 26, verse number 31, the Bible says, "And all you shall be offended because of me of this night. For it is what?
Written."
In other words, it's been prophesied. In other words, before I stood before Pilate and before I stood before the Sanhedrin Council, who should not have held a council at all, who set up an illegal trial, who met on a night they were not supposed to meet, who got judges to sway the people against me, who turned on me like dogs for political reasons. He said, before all that stuff happened, God said it was written that it was going to happen.
Uh-huh.
I want you to know that God has it all under control.
Amen.
And folk did what they were supposed to do. Peter was supposed to run.
Uh-huh.
James was supposed to run. Am I right about that? Luke was supposed to run. Am I right? Matthias was supposed to run. They're all supposed to take off. Folk who ate the fish took off running.
Uh-huh.
Folk who were saved on the ships took off running. Why'd they run? Because it was God's plan for him to be at the cross by himself.
Amen.
Well, preacher, what do you say? I'm saying that whatever happened on that day, whether 2 million didn't vote, whether it's the poorest turnout of all, do not be alone. Because you don't know if it's the will of God that what's happening is taking place and God has a master plan. Am I right about it? And I don't know, sometimes God can pick some funny people to do his work. Am I right about it? I wouldn't vote for Donald Trump because he can't get his hair straight on his head. Am I right about it? Look like a chee-chee bird. Look like a boll weasel. I can't vote for folk that can't get the hair. Am I right about it? Hey, y'all, look at me. I got some pretty hair. He got at least get to comb his hair and keep this wig or whatever that flipped over his head before he steps somebody. Amen. Anyhow, amen. Thank you, Jesus. I got to tell the truth. But God can pick some funny people to do some stuff. And God can let some stuff happen, and it'll blow our mind, and it blows our mind because we cannot fathom the power and the will of God.
Amen.
So don't be worried. Don't sit around stressing and stressing. Then there are those who did vote. Who did vote for Donald Trump? 15% of Latino Americans voted for Donald Trump. Let me say it again. 15% of Latinos voted for Donald Trump. He got half of the white American educated women to vote for him, although they heard him say on a tape that he'll grab somebody in an improper place.
Mm-hmm.
They voted for Donald Trump. A certain percentage of Afro-Americans voted for Donald Trump.
Uh-huh.
When I sit back and I look at all the things he said, and all the things he did, I couldn't imagine why in the world anybody would vote for such a monster and put him
in the White House, am I right about it? But also, when I looked at the text, I couldn't imagine folk looking at Jesus, who never wronged anybody, and vote to crucify the Son of God. Am I right about it? How could you look into those hands that heal folk just by touching them, by their eyes? And how could you look at the mouth that spoke healing and healing took place? And how could you look at the Spirit of God that sat with sinners and told folk who were marginalized that they were all right and vote the killing on the cross? It's confusing, it's perplexing, it's befuddling to me, but I read in the Word that it is written that they would not believe the report of Jesus, and that all of them would not only forsake him, but they would refuse the arm of the Lord, who should grow up before them as a tender root out of dry ground. Right about it was written that he would be despised and rejected of men, a man acquainted with sorrow and a man acquainted with grief. When I look sometime, I can't figure out what in the world is God doing. But I read in the Bible in Luke 22 that they said, and with loud shouts instantly, and demanded that he be crucified. Even in our text, crucified, crucified, crucified. I'm persuaded that God had to be standing there saying, everything is going according to plan. Am I right about it? Sometimes when you're going through hell in your life and you can't figure out why you're going through what you're going through. Why now should I get sick? Why now should I get laid off? Why now should I be going through one thing or another? God is saying everything is going according to plan. Y'all have to say amen. I wish you look at each other and say, it's all going according to God's plan. Can you look at your neighbor and say, it's going according to God's plan? Am I right about it? Might not understand it, might can't fathom it, but everything is in God's hand. Am I right about it? As I move on a little farther, I just want to test the scriptures just a little bit. Deuteronomy 13, 1 through 5, the Lord your God is testing you. I want you to know that sometime when you're going through stuff, God is allowing you to go through stuff. God has it all in control. When we look at this great text, he says that he is testing you to find out whether or not that you love him. It is here that I see that God was 100% God and 100% man, because the Bible says in Romans chapter 6 that he was depending on God to raise him up. It says it like this, but by the glory of the Father, he was raised up from the dead. In other words, when Jesus was getting ready to face the cross, he had to learn to trust his Father to lift him up. Am I right about it? He had to count on God. How do you know? You remember he was up on that cross. He said, into your hands I commend my spirit. In other words, I'm going to take this human side of me, and I'm going to put it in your hands, and I'm going to trust you. You're going to raise me up, but not that I've doubted you for 1 minute, but I'm going to trust that it'll mean something to somebody. See, Daddy, before I died, the folk were laughing at me. Daddy, before I died, the folk act like they didn't care. You want me to die on the cross? I'll be obedient even to the cross, Philippians 2 and 5. But Daddy, I got a problem right now because I'm groaning in the spirit. Daddy, the folk are spitting on me. Daddy, they're gambling at the cross. You sure this thing ain't gonna work? Don't look like none of these folk care about me. Have you ever felt like didn't nobody care about you? Have you ever felt like what you were doing for nothing? Have you ever felt like all folk wanted was something for you? Have you ever felt like God had forsaken you? Wake it up on the cross that God declared himself. He said, Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani. What did that mean? My God, my God, why has thou forsaken me? He did not lack faith in God. He lacked faith in you doing what you were supposed to do. You're crucified. Hung him afresh. Put him to the open shade. Chose the devil over him. And he said, is the plan going to work, God? Well, that comes to the last part of my sermon. We better stop trying to figure out what God is doing on the spiritual side and start trusting God. Am I right?
Amen.
We better learn that Donald Trump, Bill Clinton, Hillary Clinton, Obama ain't running nothing. God got it all. God got it all under control.
Amen.
Donald Trump's in the White House because God wanted in the White House. Have you looked at how scared Donald Trump looked right now? Every interview he done got quiet. He done stopped talking about that wall. He looked nervous. He even combed his hair right. Y'all know what I'm saying? He done got on a good foot. Whatever God doing to him, it must be a lot of pressure on him. Because he looks like he want to know Jesus right now. Folk acting a fool, clowning, throwing stuff. You don't know the mind of God. To rebel against what's happened is rebel against God's power. For you to stop Jesus from going to the cross, Jesus said, my war is not of this world. If it was in this world, I could call down angels. They deliver me from you. But he that will deliver you has given you the greatest sin. Well, what do you mean? We don't need to rebel. We don't need to fight. We don't need to go around and talk about what I don't. We go to bed at night. His way is past finding out. Either you trust God or you don't trust
him.
I've learned the devil has never been able to outfox God. Y'all know what I'm saying to me? You remember in First Corinthians chapter 1, I believe, he said, had the princes of this world, 2 Corinthians chapter 1 said, princes of the world knew they're killing the Son of God. If they knew that they would actually save the world, he said they would have never crucified him in the first place. God was standing there looking at him saying, yeah, take me to the cross, checkmate. Am I right about it? I got a feeling somewhere up in the heavens. God is looking down, smiling, looking at folk. I ain't going to vote now. He said, you know what you're supposed to do. I'm going to go vote for you. You know what you're supposed to do. I'm upset. That's all right. You need to learn how to trust me. But when the numbers were read and the fake Sanhedrin council came back, the electoral college vote, God said, that's real funny. Checkmate. You just watch what happened next. I'm not predicting something horrible to happen. I'm saying God is about to show up in America. God is about to redeem his people. God is about to move his people. God is about to do something big for his people. And instead of worrying about what he going to do to us, we ought to be worrying about what God is getting ready to do for us.
Amen.
God getting ready to do something for us. I believe it. I believe it. Listen, as I go in conclusion, the Bible says in Psalms 92, 4 and 5, for thou hast made me glad through thy work. I don't know how the work is going to come out, but I know God is always at work. Am I right about it? I don't know how he's going to fix your situation at the house, but I know he's a homemaker. Am I right about it? I can see the song that's saying, Psalms 127, except the Lord build a house, they that labor in vain. Am I right about it? He said, except the Lord watch the city. The city man watch it in vain. But this is the part I like about God, and not worrying about what God's doing. Not worrying about what man is doing, but worrying about what God is doing. He said, it's foolish for you to miss sleep worrying about Donald Trump being in office. Am I right about it? He said, that's foolish of you to spend time. Some of us can't even eat no more because he got in office. Some of us are moving to Canada and running like he got some kind of power. Don't you know Trump can't trump God? God a trump on him. Am I right about it? God a trump him. We serve a good God. And God said, he said, go to sleep. So what I want you to do tonight and stop doing it at church is go to sleep when you get home. Lay down and go to sleep. Get you some sleep. Stop worrying about this, stop worrying about that, and get you some sleep. And start preparing for what God is going to do and how God is going to do it. Because heaven is prepared people, a prepared place for prepared people.
Amen.
And the question to you, are you prepared for the next 4 years? If Christ came back in the next 4 years, are you prepared to meet your God?
Amen.
Nah, I was too busy worried about Donald Trump. Are you prepared to meet your Lord? If you're not, the way you become prepared, you've heard the word of God. Do you believe what you've heard? Repent of your sins. Confess him to be Lord in your life and put him on in baptism. You can leave here no matter who's president. Have the King of Kings, Prince of Princes, Lord of Lords working in your life. And no matter what happens, God is in control. We don't need to rebel. We need to rejoice.
Amen.
Because God has a plan. The psalmist said in Psalm 92 that his thoughts and his works are too deep for me to know.
Mm-hmm.
If you try to figure out why God did what he did, you're going to drive yourself crazy.
Mm-hmm.
The reason that you're so frustrated now, you're trying to know the mind of God. It's too deep for you to know.
Amen.
I wish somebody look at somebody and say, it's too deep. It's too deep. Y'all got to say it like it's deep. It's too deep. It's too deep. I don't even want to talk about it. It's too deep for us to know. God has it all in front. We understand. Saying the Son of Heaven, seven invitations of heaven is waiting, and mercy is waiting.